Last Sunday, Pastor David preached on listening, and James 1, verse 19 was the main nucleus of that passage when it says, everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. This week, we're going to pick up the second half of that. You see, we're on the road to integrity, which is our sermon series through the book of James. And as we work our way through what James has to say to us, the part of listening is important, but then he follows that with the idea of doing. And we're going to pick up James's letter with the doing part. Pastor David explained how important it is to guard what we're listening to. And what voices that we allow to have influence in our lives. And one of the voices that I listen to, just to be transparent with you, I listen to a lot of things. I listen to some very nerdy podcasts. I love podcasts. I listen to a lot of audiobooks as well. I listen to a lot of Christian authors and speakers. And I also listen to many who are not Christians. But it depends on what the topic is. But I am very careful of the content that I allow in my own mind, my own ears, and in the minds and the ears of my kids and our family, as parents do. But one that you may or may not be aware of is a Christian singer by the name of Nathan Feirstein, who is the younger generation, if you're listening, may know him better by his initials as the rapper NF. Despite his machine gun flow and his style of rapping, his lyrics are very, very powerful. And as we look through this road of integrity with James, I want to share a snippet of one of his songs called O Lord. I cannot do it justice, but I want to slow it down. He is very fast. I want to slow it down, and I want you to listen to NF's words. He says, it's easy to blame God, but harder to fix things. We look in the sky like, why ain't you listening? Watching the news in our living rooms on the big screens and talking about if God's really real, then where is he? You see, the same God that you say might not even exist becomes real to us, but only when we're dying in bed. When you're healthy, it's like we don't really care for him. Then leave me alone, God. I'll call you when I need you again, which is funny. Everyone will sleep in the pews. Then blame God for our problems like he's sleeping on you. We turn our backs on him. What do you expect him to do? It's hard to answer prayers when nobody's listening to you. I look around at this world we walk on. It's a smack in the face. Don't ever tell me there's no God. And if there isn't, then what are we here for? And why aren't y'all, what are y'all doing down there? And he responds, I don't know, Lord. In a microwave, self-serving, fast-paced world, it's easy to let our prayer life and our view of God move to a more like God being our butler. There are people, and I'm not going to call out names, but there's a movement called the New Apostolic Reformation, and they're very much the whole name it and claim it type mentality of you just have to name this thing that you need or want, and God will do it for you, and speak those words into the atmosphere of the air. And I want to tell you that that is theological and biblical garbage. Now, there are things that God has declared, and you can go along with what God has already declared and said because he is God, but that type of mentality in the church is actually dangerous because it turns your view of God or Christ or the Holy Spirit into a butler of, well, I have spoken it, therefore it must happen. And you and I are not the ones who tell God what to do. It is us who are in line with what God has already said. NF reflects, as he reflects, people often sleep in the pews and then blame God. They look for blessing and they look for answers. They look for God to move, yet they don't even move themselves. And then they're left with this question. And here's the question I want to leave you with. How do we find blessing? Title of my sermon today is Just Do It. Yes, I stole it from Nike. And more appropriately, don't lie to yourself. Just do it. Now, I'm not talking about Nike. I'm not talking about athletics. I'm talking about our walk with the Word of God. And to find the answer to that question, we're going to go to James. How do we find blessing? Let's open the scripture. But before we do, I want you to repeat after me. Say it with me. Say, I love God's word. It feeds me, it guides me, and it directs me. And boy, will it today when we read James, because just like Pastor Michael said a while back, it kind of gives you a kick in the rear when you read James. He doesn't mess around. He gets right to the point. And that's part of the reason I love it, and it also hurts when I read. We're going to read in James chapter 1 today, verses 22 to 25, picking it right up where Pastor David left off last week. And it says this, as you read along with me, I'm reading out of the NIV. It says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. I'm going to say it again. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like a man who looks at his face in the mirror, and after looking at himself, he goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does. Just do it. Just do it. I get questions all the time as a pastor. People are like, oh, well, you're in ministry. You know, what should I do? Do what God's word says. And I'm going to get into that today as well. But sometimes we think, well, I need to pray. I need to do this. And sometimes God's like, I already told you. You don't need to pray about whether or not you should be generous to someone. You don't need to pray about whether or not you should pray for someone. Just do it. Have you ever met someone who placates? They say they're going to eat right. I'm working on it. They're going to exercise. I'm working on it. But I'm not doing it right, obviously. They say they're going to study. They say they're going to do their assignment. I'm a teacher, hear it all the time. Oh, yes, Mr. Campbell, I'll get it done. I'll get it done. Nothing happens. They say they're going to finish that project or that report that they're working on at work. Those of you bosses, you're like, oh, yes, I need them to finish it, right? Or the kids are going to do that chore, but they don't do it. And you just want to say, just do it. Get it done. They know what to do, but they don't actually do it. Listening is important, but if we merely listen and sleep in our pews, nothing will happen. We deceive ourselves because we do nothing. And yet James challenges us to actually do what God's word tells us to do. I want to title this first point, merely listening and not doing is self-deception. I want you to say it with me, even though you're watching me on the screen. Do it. Just do it. Merely listening and not doing is self-deception. James, later in his book in chapter 5, verse 16, he says, the prayer of a righteous man and woman, righteous person, the prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. But it's hard for God to answer prayers that are never prayed. He already knows what you're going to pray, but there is an act of obedience of you actually coming in line with God when you pray. It's not that he doesn't know, he knows. He's sovereign. But there is a component where we need to be participants as well. Have you ever gone into a room or like the kitchen or the garage and you go in there and then you go, oh, wait, what did I come in here for? And you like have to literally walk out of the kitchen or the garage to remember what it was. And it's almost like you look at a thing, like our pantry, like our a lot of our extra food and stuff, we do our Costco run, right? And it's, you know, we come like a truckload of food and we're putting things away and we have a spot and an extra fridge in our garage. And so maybe we're out of milk and we have extra milk in the garage fridge or something. And I go in there and then I get in the garage and there's everything in there and I'm distracted and thinking about all these different things. And then I forget why I'm in the garage. And I go, why am I in here? What am I getting? And then I have to walk out and then go back and see that my daughter's empty bowl or dry bowl of cereal, she needs milk and I need to get the milk. and I forget, and I have to like walk out. It's hilarious because I think about, I can remember all these songs from the 80s and the 90s. I remember Jenny's phone number, 8675309, but I can't remember why I went into the garage. My grandma calls those senior moments. I turned 40 this year. I'm really worried if I'm having senior moments and I'm still in my 30s. I want to claim as long as I got it. I only have a few months left to be in my 30s. And I'm a little worried if I have senior moments there. I think my grandma, actually, she just likes to use that as an excuse. And says, I don't recall. That's Grandma Campbell's excuse. She's really good at it. And kids, you may be laughing at us old people, but you're not off the hook either. You do the same thing. We ask you to take out the trash. We ask you to empty the dishwasher. And then your response is, but I know. This is the teenage response, right? I know. And you walk into the kitchen to do what we asked you to do, and you weren't really listening. And then you come back and go, wait, what did you want me to do? See, you're not off the hook either. We laugh at this, and we can all relate, but this is what James is actually talking about, to bring this back to the word. I wanted to get practical, but let's come back here. When he tells us that it is like a man who looks at his face in the mirror, and after looking at himself, he goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. And this is what NF, in his rap, in his song, was getting at when he says, it's funny, everyone will sleep in the pews, then blame God for our problems like he's sleeping on you. We turn our backs on him. What do you expect him to do? It's hard to answer prayers when nobody's praying to you. Merely listening and not doing is self-deception. So just do it. So then we come to the blessing, and James's passage here is really broken into two parts. The first one is the listening and doing and remembering and not being like the man in the mirror. But then James's point moves into blessing being found by doing what God commands. Say it with me. Blessing is found, I'm pausing for you, blessing is found by doing what God commands. Blessing is found by doing what God commands. Verse 25 says, but the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does. Our question, where do we find blessing? Not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it. He will be blessed in what he does. So you want to say, God, we want you to bless, then do what God said. It's that simple. It's like telling our kids, you want to earn your allowance, then do your chores. It's a very simple idea. You want to see God move in your life, then live in obedience to what God has called us to do. Not because it's like God saying, well, you obeyed me, so I'll bless you. It's that if you want to live under the covering of my blessing, then get under it. And here's how that looks. In his commentary on this passage, a very famous Matthew Henry, very famous theologian, he says this, and it's a little older in his language, but I want you to listen carefully. It says, hearing is in order to doing. The most attentive and the most frequent hearing of the word of God will not avail us unless we be also doers of it. He pulls from the King James language of this, and let us not be hearers only, but also doers of the word. Maybe that's a little more familiar to you in the language. He continues, it's not enough to remember what we hear. Bare hearers are self-deceivers. Self-deceit will be found the worst deceit at last because we lie to ourselves. And as James focuses his message on his fellow Israelites, this whole book is written, as he writes in the very beginning, to the 12 tribes scattered amongst the nations. This is the diaspora, as we call it. It's the scattered people from after the Assyrians and the Babylonians and the Persians and the Greeks and now the Romans. They have been constantly scattering Jews and Israelites across their empires. And yet they've held on to their faith. And he's writing to Jewish Christians in the first century. He's writing to his fellow Israelites, and the reason for the fall of Jerusalem under the Babylonians would have been in the backs of their minds. You see, a lot of what the backsetting of the New Testament is built off of actually revolts that happened in between the Old and New Testament, but we don't see writings about it. We have all kinds of history about that, but the Bible itself doesn't refer to those things. But this is the setting that happens to set up the time frame for the New Testament. That was fresh in their mindset. That was like us studying American history for us. It was normal to think about. And it was powerful and personal history for them because in the fall of Jerusalem, God spoke to the prophet Ezekiel. And this is about 600 years before James is writing this. And he explains why Jerusalem fell to the Babylonians. In Ezekiel 33, verses 31 to 32, God says this to the prophet Ezekiel. He says, "My people come to you, Ezekiel, as they usually do, and sit before you," as Ezekiel prophesies and he preaches and teaches and all of that, "to listen to your words, but they do not put them into practice. With their mouths, they express devotion, but their hearts are greedy for unjust gain. Indeed, to them, you are nothing more than one who sings love songs with a beautiful voice and plays an instrument well." And I have this underlined, "For they hear your words, but do not put them into practice." They hear, but they don't do. Just do it. Just do it. You see, we have an opportunity to see God work in powerful ways. But we can't and we shouldn't expect to see him work when we live like, and I'm sorry if it sounds offensive, and I know you're watching online, but please don't misunderstand me, when we live like couch potato Christians. Now, if you're watching this and you're sitting on your couch, that's not what I mean. But if we never get up and actually live out the word of God, then we are just couch potato Christians. We all have limited time on this earth. And even in this same letter, James addresses it as well. This is all James, you guys. Because he says this in chapter 4, verse 14, "You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes." And he talks about how brief our opportunity and how brief our time is on this earth. You see, God has placed each and every one of us in the situation we are in on purpose. And over the past few years, I've heard this repeated refrain over and over and over from very different sources that are not connected. And this is exactly what it has been saying to me. And I feel like God has given it for me to share to you, but also to apply to my own life. And it goes like this, and it's been said different ways, but this is the gist of it. You could have been born at any time in history, but God put you here at this place and in this time on purpose. We're always complaining about what's happening with COVID and everything, and I'm so sick and tired of talking about COVID. We're tired about issues that are in politics. We're tired about issues with inflation. We're tired, all these things in our society and our culture, and yet here is the thing. God chose you to be born and to be here for such a time as this. Which is exactly what Mordecai told Esther when she saved the entire Israelite people from being extinct. You too were born for such time as this, but if we do nothing, then it's pointless. A few months ago, all of us, the pastoral team at the church, we went to our annual pastor's conference over in Coeur d'Alene. And one of our speakers is an evangelist. His name is Sean Smith. And he put this very succinctly, and I love this, and you can write this down. Listen carefully, I'm gonna say it twice. The opportunity of a lifetime must be fulfilled within the lifetime of the opportunity. I'm gonna say it again, I messed it up. The opportunity of a lifetime must be seized within the lifetime of the opportunity. You see, not every opportunity that God puts in front of you they have an expiration date. There's a window of time for certain things, and God puts things in front of us because we prepared us for those moments, but we can't let them pass us by. Let us be encouraged and challenged alongside James's original audience of these early Jewish Christians. We can't sit back and just listen to God's word. This is a great sermon. Okay, wonderful. You like it, and maybe you don't. You're listening to it, but if you do nothing after you turn off this video, then it's a complete waste of my time and your time and God's time. We have to live out our faith. We can't just sit back and listen to God's word. We have to put it into practice. We have to actually, as Nike says, just do it. Because blessing is found by doing what God commands us to do. And then the following question from that would be, so then what does that mean? What does God want me to do? What does the Bible tell us to do? Well, let me tell you, since you asked. It actually goes perfectly in line with our church's mission of loving and growing and serving. Loving God and loving others, and serving God and serving others, and growing in God and growing with others. And as we love, the Bible tells us in Matthew 22, love God with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. James 1:27 says, care for the disenfranchised and the marginalized, for widows and orphans. Love and respect your spouse. Love your kids too, and don't exasperate them. Act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. And grow. Read God's word. Pray without ceasing. Seek first God's kingdom. Deny your own fleshly desires. Pick up your cross and follow Christ. And serving. Make disciples. Preach the word. Don't give up meeting together. Go to church. Not because God needs you here. It's because we need each other. Be his witnesses locally, regionally, and globally. And be a good steward of God's money. It's not yours. It's his, not 10%, all of it. It's all his. Be outrageously generous with God's money. These are the things that God tells us to do. This is how we love and we grow and we serve with God and with humanity. This is the whole breaking down of love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. The first half of the Ten Commandments are our relationship with God, and the second half of the Ten Commandments are our relationship with other people. This is what God has called us to do. So let's just do it. Father, we just pray that you would give us the boldness. Because sometimes we're scared and sometimes we're lazy. Sometimes we don't know how to act or what to do. And I pray that your Holy Spirit would prompt us, give us wisdom, and give us opportunities to just do what you've called us to do. Because we know that you have put us on this earth and where we are and when we live and the people around us on purpose. Help us, God, to live out your word and just do it. We thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Tear down the walls, dance in the freedom.